Well, fix that. Okay, let's get the lead client over here. Am I super quiet or is that just me? Worm Tate, how's the sound? First time running anything out of OBS, and so I'm like, have no idea if anything's working. Audible. Let me know if I need to turn it up, down, anywhere in between. Apparently, Lady Elise wanted to join me in the casting booth, but I do not see her online. Should probably hop in Discord to see if anybody else wants to join, but which one will we hop into? We'll hop down into spectator chat. Cool. Let's launch this Gamba. See if I can do this right. Oh, Nikolai didn't understand that all of AR has changed their names to some variation of Lady Elise, and therefore he was confused as to why I'm here and Elise is not here. Now I see. Okay, and we are off already. Let's get draft lull. Looking at a Xin Zhao ban, classic against our good boy Adam. That is a very normal ban. The Xayah ban response from THD. I think that is a Nick Mead target. I've hit him with that ban many a times. Vel'Koz. Good old Blazon in the mid lane. Target ban. Let's see. Start prediction. Who will win game one? Will win game one? With lots of question marks. We'll come one. GB, because it's blue. THD, because that one's pink. Xerath. Ooh, we're flying through these pick hands. Good lord. Okay. Nocturne immediately locked in for GB. That is a interesting pick. It does not seem like a Nishant pick nor a Nikolai pick, so I'm not exactly sure where that Nocturne's going. It's a nice takeaway from Caribou, but to be determined on where that's going. Submission period. We want 15 minutes. Start that prediction. I understand that the outcome, blah, 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 blah. Cool. Predictions live, folks. So, yeah, we got an Ash response. Interesting, slightly immobile and squishy for a Nocturne, but also a good cross map. Nocturne can kind of eat her ult with a spell shield, but maybe as a Noct main, I am preferential to this matchup. And Nautilus, I like this bottom lane. Very sticky. You get tapped by one of their abilities and the other can immediately follow up. Ash slows anybody and Nautilus is going to have a good old time with his hooks. But follow it up with a Rakan. Good disengage, play safe, support whatever bottom laner that GB ends up drafting. I don't think I've seen Schluckbeer on Rakan, so this is interesting. And I like the Galio Nocturne. This is a tried and true combo. Galio jumps the Ash, or Nocturne jumps the Ash. Galio comes over his shoulder and says, "Hello. You got feared by this Nocturne? Allow me to knock you up into the air and then smash you back down." So, like that. Potent combo. Lots of dive coming out of GB. Let's see how THD responds to this amount of dive. Trundle. Okay. Takes away some of the tankiness of the Galio. It is a pretty good pick in Adam's hands, and I think it's generically just a good jungle to take off the table right now if they want to save mid and top for second rotation. They're waiting a long while on this ban, though. Jhin. Interesting. This is actually, I think, the first time all season when I prepped GB draft for our game. I think this is the first time all season Nick Mead's pick has gone to the second half of the draft phase. It's normally bot support jungle in like 95% of occasions for GB. So this Nocturne Galio Rakan is something they've, this amount of dive is something GB's clearly prepped in advance, which I like to see. Taking away Singed. I don't know if two hands, maybe he's been playing some Singed. I'm not super familiar with his champ pool. I know he plays eclectic stuff, but Singed is somewhat interesting. Aurelia off the table. Don't want Steven to get his hands on that. Respect ban. Totally understand it. Then Syndra. They are hitting Blazon. Artillery mages are gone. But I've seen this man pull out some assassins, and he can be very potent. You think you've put him in a corner by isolating his picks, and then he pulls out an Akali or something and destroys you. So we'll see what THD do. They take Cassiopeia. Interesting. Also somewhat immobile, but can definitely zone fights with the Miasma. Too many people dive on top of her. She just hits them with a big ult. Ends up pretty squishy and survivable herself, so I can see this pick performing well, but I think it's going to require very good spacing. Whether it's going mid or top, because I don't actually know. Jinx. For the Nick Mead. Good scaling option. Lots of people to protect Jinx and get in front of her. Allow him to get excited and take off in some of these fights. Follow up on Nocturne Galio engages with a rocket. I like this, especially with the Rakan. And what do they round out the comp with? Gwen for Steven. I think this is the first, maybe second time we've seen Gwen actually get picked this season. I know she's been banned a handful of times against a few people, but hasn't really seen much favor. I think it's interesting. I think it's a good counter rather than like a Fiora into any tank matchups, effectively saying run the Noddle or run the Malphite, run Sion, run Cassante, and Gwen will chop them up. So I like this as a early, just don't pick a tank into this. And they take Quinn. Holy moly. Okay, so THD says, "Oh, that's cute. You don't want us to play a tank? Sure, we'll just play Quinn." And I have no idea how that matchup goes. I have no idea how almost any Quinn matchups go. But exciting stuff. Huge focus on top lane. Has a little bit of dive, but we'll see how this goes. We're getting R's in chat. Let me swap over to the League client. And let's get this started. Okay, so looking at our Gambas real quick, we've got a, what's it called? Was that a solid 51,000 points on THD? 51,000 already. That's a, GB. We've got Alki and Bananas giving GB some love, but that paltry 1,800 points does not quite outweigh Worm's 51,000 on THD. Adam only putting 190 points on himself on THD, which is a bit depressing. I would expect more love for his own team, but, you know, maybe hedging his bets a little bit. He sees this dive comp, and he's like, damn, things could get spicy real quick. And hedging his bets a little bit. But I don't think we're going to see any surprise swaps or moves out of either team here. Looking at the drafts, I think everything is pretty box standard. God, I need to turn off my Discord notifications. Stop hearing the ba-dump. Let me do that so y'all aren't having to hear it. Where is Discord? There it is. 0-0. Hopefully that works and helps. Unless somebody joins, then I have to turn it back up. Oh, the quandary. I'm going to do a little bit of research real quick. This Quinn versus Gwen matchup. My lack of knowledge in top lane is showing, but we'll see. Quinn. Top lane. How do you do on the old Gwen? I assume Quinn just kind of kicks her in the face. Actually looks not great for Quinn. Quinn's got a 53% win rate overall, and against Gwen, it's only 51, so almost a 2% drop. That's a not awesome, but you know what? I will trust. I'll trust old two hands pulling out a spicy pick, and I'll trust he knows what he's doing. And I'm just a dumb jungler who only knows how to auto minions that don't want to fight. They're just trying to live in their peaceful camps. Surprised all of the THD love. I feel like their comp is just so much harder to execute. Like, the only thing in this comp that makes, like, tons of sense to me is Ash Nautilus. The rest of it might just be, like, comfort. But GB's comp is, like, we go one direction and one direction only. And I don't think there's a lot that THD has to really neutralize a Nocturne Galio jumping on this Ash or jumping on this Quinn. Like, if I'm Nocturne, I'm sitting here licking my lips. Like, the only person I'm not going to be able to kill really mid to late is Nautilus and this Trundle if he gets ahead. The rest of it's a pretty big field day for Nocturne if he builds Lethality. But, yeah, I think I'm the only one in BTL who builds straight Lethality Nocturne, but we'll see. Maybe Nishant will surprise me. I hope he surprises me. Normally this, like, Ash Cassiopeia comp, I see Cass and, like, Trundle Pillar, you would see Cassiopeia go probably Aralize at some point. And I'm sitting here going, man, if GB were super immobile, that would be awesome, because they're never going to get on top of Ash or Cass or through Trundle Pillar and Nautilus stuff. Like, you could just zone them out. But I was like, you've got very clear go buttons, whether it's Galio going on to Rakan, going on to Nocturne, Gwen's going to be diving into the back. I am sold on GB's comp here. Misa will go full Lethality knock in our game. Yeah, sure he will. That man hasn't, you know, built Lethality on Nocturne probably in like 5 or 6 seasons. But you keep telling yourself that. Okay, so chat, I think if people are voting with their points, we are vastly preferring THD here. I don't see it. Y'all are crazy. I don't see what you're seeing in THD's comp, unless Glenn can pull out some wacky Quinn shenanigans, which I just can't imagine. I'm just 6-3, the people are for GB, so the points are for THD. Okay, okay, I see. Let them cook? I'm letting them cook. I could say a lot of things, and I'm not saying them. I'm letting them cook. I love the Cassiopeia pick. This seems like a blazon pocket that will eat through some of the beefier members on GB. Lots of zone control. If he can kind of get his own space set up in team fights and not get immediately jumped, which luckily the Quinn and the Ash are likely to be the better targets for any of the divers on GB's side. So the Cassiopeia should have time to open up and sink her fangs into people. Oh, wait. Is THD doing one of their funky swaps where Angela plays AD carry and Nathan plays support? I think I've been bamboozled. I called there would be no swaps and no trickery after the draft, and they have made a fool of me. For that, I will not be predicting them. For that, I am predicting and putting my points on GB, also because value bet. And value bets are good, so. Twitch chat, or Twitch, do you not show me how many points I have? Where are my channel points? I think I have like 40k or something. Okay, somebody, let's drop solid 15. On GB. You're participating as a moderator. You created this prediction. I won't be able to choose the outcome? Oh, well, fine. Then I guess I won't participate. How lame. Cringe value better. Well, you're lucky. I can't bet, because if I bet, I can't resolve the prediction. So y'all are lucky. Oh dear, I'm going to have to close the Gambo a wee bit early. We've got 2.5 minutes left on it, but we're going into game in what? 45 seconds? So, going to have to hit that button a wee bit early. I hope y'all don't mind. Get your value bets in, fam. We got 40 seconds left. Support good boys for Nick. He's the best. I have heard similarly good things about the Nick Mead, and if you can't tell by my commentary, I think their draft is significantly superior here. And I think Nick Mead, with all of this front line and all of these people getting attention for him and dive in, he's going to have a field day on this Jinx. And not a lot to try and get on top of him. So, loading in, closing Gamba now. And let me swap over to the client. Perfect, okay. Keep me posted on game sound if it's too loud or anything. Okay, we see some pings coming out of the good boys. Looks like they're going for some sort of invade. THD looks like they are also looking for something or looking to counter. We'll see. They're stacking in a banana brush. Classic counter invade strat. Let me swap the scoreboard and things. Scoreboard. Move Angela up. Objective timers. Cool. Okay, so GB, looks like they were expecting an invade. Get some wards on their red side entrance and post back by their red. THD, funnily enough, expecting the same thing, and posts in their banana brush. I'm not sure. I'm very bad at judging level ones, so I don't know who actually wins. I feel the team with the Nautilus would win, but the other side's got a Galio, so who the hell knows? Both junglers starting bot side, getting leashes. With these early wards placed to protect both junglers' bottom sides, I'm interested to see how this ends up impacting early ganks, since people will not be have vision necessarily around their lanes with these early wards used. Okay, early trading topside. I assume Gwen at level 1, it's kind of miserable and you just get shot a lot by Quinn, but... early shove out of the GB bottom lane, hitting level 2 early, but no chaos out of that. Then Quinn continues to be a nuisance top lane. And here's the Cass. Galio, you might like being against mages, but Cassiopeia does a lot of consistent damage. Knock up onto the bot lane, quick dash out. Jungler's camp timers are even. It looks like outside of bottom lane, THG's got pressure top, got pressure mid. But an early gank top by Nashant to catch this Quinn out of position. Nose kick is down because she had just used it on the Gwen, and early flash and ghost blown off of the Quinn for little to no investment from the Nocturne. But they know he didn't have blue buff, and this is a read that if I've ever seen one, they're going to look to grab him on his Gromp. Know he doesn't have blue, so they know he's available. Then a flash out of Nocturne, and this is a dead Gwen trying to save her jungler. Good invade out of the THD topside, recognizing Nocturne didn't have blue there, and we can walk in here with the pressure Quinn has and kill him on his Gromp. Time control's off if possible. Oh. I need to speed up real quick, and then how do I get rid of those, Worm? Do you know how? Is it on the visibility? Thank you. Oh, Nashant's dead again. Or dead for the first time, excuse me. So that's a good start for the THD topside. That early read paying dividends. I think we learned, somebody asked the question last night, if auto attack enhancers go through Nocturne Spell Shield. As we saw Trundle chomp right through Nocturne Spell Shield, it does. And it's sad, but it makes sense, because it's an auto attack steroid and not a... not a spell, but. Nikolai getting a huge trade on Demazed Mecha, who started tier and pots early, so he's just looking to stack, play safe, and luckily Galio's a lane where he can do that, but Nikolai says, no, I'm not gonna let you stack without at least taking some of your HP. Steven's ghosting. This might be a kill onto the flashless Quinn, but he backs off after getting blinded. Gank mid. Caribou's got pillar. Throws it. Flash hook. And that is a dead Galio if I've ever seen one. Great rotation out of Tactical Gazelle. Great follow-up on the blown flash. After he sees the hook go, or after he sees the pillar go down, he knows the Galio is flashless. He commits for the fight. Knows he can hit that hook and takes it. Controls shift Z. Oh my god, thank you. I know people like talk about that one all the time, and I like always have forgotten that one. Control shift Z. What, zoom out? I think that's a good view. Please tell me how to live my life, because clearly you know how to live it better than I do. I always forget that command and how to zoom out. So overall, Caribou off to a pretty large lead in the jungle. 2-0-1, up around two camps. He's got his wolves and his whole topside to clear right now, so he's about to continue to expand that lead. And that's good to see, given, you know, he probably needs to be off to an early start to kind of dissuade some of this dive out of the Nocturne and the Galio come level 6. Nikolai is making a play bot side, looking to maybe see if the Rakan goes in, if he can ulti over the top with Galio 6, but sees his wave crashing back mid and is returning to his tower. Lots of vision invested by both teams in the bottom side river. Trying to cover that dragon, but with junglers on the top side, it doesn't look like either team is going to be looking to touch the Drake quite yet. Nocturne hovering the Gwen, but without six, there's not a real gank threat here. But Two Hands could be walking into his death, and this looks like it's going to be a dead Quinn. No flash. Excellent blast cone, but Caribou says no. I'm going to bonk you on the head and steal all of this Galio's resistances, protect my top laner, and ultimately, no death, just a ghost blown out of the Quinn. Once again, feeling a little bit insecure with both sums down, but gets out alive by the skin of her teeth. Both junglers take a reset. Nocturne will be hitting six soon. Galio still has ulti, so it'll be interesting to see where these two commit these impactful ultimates. Nocturne going Hearthbound Axe, so sadly not going Lethality. I will shed a tear, but the thing is, though, is even though Nocturne's about to hit six, the THD bottom lane is also about to be six. Asian Problems, in fact, on the Ash is already six, so even if they commit for that, there's a lot of disengage out of that bottom lane. But they will just take the lane pressure they have, Nocturne being bot side, and say, hey, let's take this dragon. Cassiopeia's still catching mid. Trundle's got no ulti. We've got four men here. And that is a dead lizard if I've ever seen one. Bit late on the rotation, but Cassiopeia and Trundle heading topside look like they want to start the Herald in response. And luckily with Nocturne having not cleared any of his camps, not quite being six yet, needs to go back into his jungle and clear, which is going to give THD a pretty easy take on this Rift Herald. 9 minute level six on the Nocturne is kind of rough, but with all the attention they were getting paid early game with the invades topside, it's not a fun situation to be in. Rocket harass out of the Jinx, because why not? Pad those damage numbers. Got to get those BTL stats up. You're finally seeing the Nocturne 6, but THG bot lane is gone. He's got no mid laner to speak of in his lane right now, and he is all the way on bottom side, so not a lot of targets for this poor Nock. Good ward topside to hopefully cover the potential Nocturne gank, but quickly cleared. Now Two Hands knows with how shoved up he is, he has to play safe, and that Quinn goes back to base. Ghost up soon, flashes up, so Quinn is feeling a bit safer, and with Valor to fly back to lane, isn't going to miss out on much, if any, of this CS as Steven shoves in topside. Tactical Gazelle has returned mid lane to support his Cassiopeia. It's like, eh. Angela's fine to catch creeps under tower. I'm just gonna throw my hook around elsewhere. Oop. Arrow onto the Nykmeed, who's got no cleanse into the Ash and Nautilus. And this looks like it's gonna be a dead Jinx. Flashing into the wave, but the Galio ult's coming down. They could turn this. They turn and kill Asian Problems. And now they're turning. The excited Jinx is trying to get away, but a flash out of Tactical Gazelle keeps. Ooh, does not keep him alive. Ends up trading two for one. But this is a big... Ooh. Dashes right into the column. This is a big Trundle. Ults the Galio for the resistances. Nocturne ults a little too early, maybe to dissuade them. But ultimately, this looks like it's going to go overwhelmingly in THD's favor. Huge ult onto the Gwen, rooting her in place. And now Cassiopeia, is she going to be able to get through the Nocturne? It looks like she will. And ultimately, what? A 4-for-3? 5-for-3. That was, I think, the full GB team committed to that bot side fight. And ultimately ends up going in the favor of THD there. Yeah, I agree. That was a huge THD play. This gets the Cassiopeia off the ground. Caribou, despite going down, has been a part of 7 of 8 kills. That is a sub 12 minute Sunderer out of this Trundle. This Trundle is going to be chomping down on anybody who dare gets in his way. Both sums out of this Jinx, whereas the bot lane out of THD, there's an Ashe arrow up again, and that Ashe has got flash. So, like, this is a Jinx that is now in a very worrisome position. Ultimately, yeah, that puts THD 2,500 up this early in the game. Down a dragon, but you know what? They're starting to get some pressure bot side with that win and probably can look to contest the next Drake. Amazed Mecha, indeed. Cassiopeia with a casual 12-minute, what's it called? Rod. That thing is going to be, so 22 minutes, going to have a fully stacked rod. That's a pretty big win for THD. Meanwhile, the Quinn topside didn't have to come down for that fight, and she ends up just equalizing the CS differential that had been forming up top. Shelly popped a little shallow. Looks like Trundle's going to rotate up to help make sure Shelly crashes, and Nikolai gets blocked, and got to remember, Galio goes backwards when he goes to punch, and we're having another fight bottom side, the flashless, sumless Jinx. However, Asian Problems has to back off to not get killed here. Ends up looking like it's just going to be supportal combat. The 280 carries, the two squishy boys can't do much. Huge Trundle pillar. And the Cassiopeia is here. This looks like a dead bottom lane. Oh, don't let him bleed down to poison. That's just mean. That's just mean. Then finishes off with a Cass Q. The double support bottom lane. Tactical Gazelle and Asian Problems. No, you get the kill. No, please, you have the kill. They're just willing to offer it to each other. Yeah, this is definitely a Adam and Blazon show. We're seeing objective bounties come up before 15 minutes. Nocturne gank topside. Misses his Q, which is a lot of his damage threat. And without that, I don't think they're going to be able to finish off this kill. Glenn, I don't know if you wanted to walk back into the Gwen, but you know what? Glenn, Gwen, Quinn. God, that's a lot of confusing double N names. Topside. Ultimately, gank ends up netting them a kill, a death on Kairosaki Ace, but it's an execute. So, you know, you take what you can get. So if I am GB, I'm looking at this, you know, staring down a 4K gold lead at 15 minutes. I know I've got a dragon to my name, so I'm not super threatened by the stack. I think they've got to concentrate some effort onto this Cassiopeia. Take this bounty off. I think these kill bounties will be huge. And getting back in, I don't think they're going to be able to necessarily contest this Herald. You've got an early roam out of the THD support, giving a man advantage up here. Oop, misses the hook. That's a Mickey X hook if I've ever seen one. Just casually toss it into the wall. Nobody saw that. Still makes knock blow spell shield. So you know what? The threat was there, and he got the key spell out that he wanted to. An easy Herald for THD. Oop. Yeah, that is the sadness of Trundle. You've used your abilities, and the Gwen just goes, hey, there's a wall right here. I'm going to dash over it. Huge! First turret and plates and bounty for the bot side of GB, and with that, objective bounties are falling off. So big win for the GB bottom lane. Ghost out of Gwen, looking to jump onto the Trundle, but I don't know if they want this Trundle. Evidently, I'm wrong. They do want this Trundle. Huge 600 gold bounty onto Nikolai. Don't tell the boys. Getting the Galio back in the game. Continuing to dive onto the Quinn. We've got fights all over the map. These teams don't want me to be able to cast properly. And it looks like the Cassiopeia is going to get another kill topside. Actually, Quinn gets it, but you know what? Cass is there to help. Nocturne's got ulti. Dives onto the Quinn. But Quinn's just going to kick him in the face and say, no, I don't want to deal with you. He's going to get eaten up by this Cassiopeia. The Quinn is still alive. Kicks Rakan in the face. And now is the Rakan going to die for Nocturne Sins? No, Rakan is going to get out. The Gwen is going to get out. But ultimately, this Cassiopeia is feasting. Okay, Angela, I like the flash play. I'm not sure the flash volley is enough to get the job done, but I respect putting the fear of God in them. Another tower goes the way of THD, and we just commented that objective bounties were down, and now they are back up. Coming back up, I believe. And in all that craziness we saw topside, the THD had dropped Shelly, who ends up getting the second tier top tower in all that craziness and chasing in the top river. So that's a lot of pressure topside, a very long lane, and open inhibitor tower access. So something GB's got to keep on the back of their mind, but also somewhere safe for the Jinx to farm. So, you know, having a lane like that where she can sit so close to her base makes it a lot easier for her to just, you know, kind of farm it out and start scaling up. Let the Gwen take a side lane, the longer lane, and hopefully give them install for some time. Going on to the Nautilus. Nathan doesn't have a lot of support behind him, but you know what? He's just throwing that weight around. You never know. Nautilus walks up to you, and you don't know if the team's behind him. A big fight looking for this third dragon, though. Vision control getting established by THD. Gwen has TP, Quinn does not, and Quinn's got a long way to go to pressure anything topside with how deep that lane is. So Steven's looking to take his recall topside and likely start pathing down to Dragon, knowing, hey, this Quinn's got no pressure up here. I'm going to make my way down there so that we have some pressure from this objective spawns, and they've got to make a choice of stopping the Quinn or contesting. But Quinn says, you know what? I recognize this too, and here I am. Valor, carry me down. We recognize this could be a make-or-break fight. Really blowing the game open if we can win this one. And so the Quinn is here. And with that knowledge, it looks like GB is going to back off, send Steven back top with his TP, and concede this only the second Drake to the side of THD. Ocean Soul, though. Ocean Soul on Cassiopeia, Ocean Soul on Trundle. Oof. Don't want to try and get through either of those champions with an Ocean Soul. I suppose Gwen and Galio are almost as obnoxious, but I like Ocean Soul. But just build Spirit Visage on anybody. It doesn't matter if you're an assassin. Doesn't matter if you're a mage. Doesn't matter if you're an AD carry. Build Spirit Visage when you get Ocean Soul, ladies and gentlemen. It'll keep you alive, I'll tell you what. THG have just got so much pressure on this map. There's no real good lane states for anybody on GB. It's really hard for anybody to come up to this top lane and hold when it's this far out. Mid lane, you've got the Jinx who just needs to scale up and farm there, which means the Galio's got to take a long lane bot. But with how much ward coverage they have, I mean, look at those wards in bot river that they place for Dragon. Like, nobody from GB can step foot in that bot side jungle without fear of this Trundle showing up and giving him the old chomp. Oop. Early jump. We're seeing the combo come out. Okay, can they kill the Cassiopeia with the Wombo? They can indeed. That is the Wombo at work, ladies and gentlemen. I don't care if you're a 514 Cassiopeia, a 014 Cassiopeia. You commit all of those ulties, this snake will die. But will they trade in response? It looks like a fight's coming out of THD, even with their mid laner down. They are chasing aggressively. They've already taken down the Galio. There goes the Gwen. Rakan valiantly dives in front of that hook meant for his AD carry. That is a honor Schluckbeer for eating that hook, if I've ever seen one. That was a get down, Mr. President. This gives THD, despite Cass being down, an easy access to Baron. And guess who's got... what the hell? The improved teleport. I don't run teleport, I'm a jungler. Whatever the hell it's called. Cassiopeia can just TP in here if things get a little dicey. So ultimately, despite what looked like a good play out of GB to start, getting onto the Cassiopeia, getting that, you know, huge target down. Galio's TPing in, and THD says, okay, goodbye. We're no longer here. Thanks for the teleport, bud. And the Constellation Prize is a Vision Ward. Well, I don't know about y'all, but even with the dive comp, how much I was all over it and I loved it, I don't think I'm getting my 15k points back. Had to commit Nocturne ult, Galio ult, Rakan ult, Jinx rocket to just get through the Cassiopeia and still lose the ensuing fight. So I'm worried about old GB here. If they can hold on another 10, 15 minutes, Ash Arrow coming in. Are we going to see a hit? Nope, we do not see a hit. And we see the Quinn just being obnoxious topside. This counter pick has done particularly well. It was a bit dicey early with the early gank, but with that early kill, he got in the topside jungle onto the Gwen, and now this Quinn has become self-sustaining. And she's like, no, Gwen, you don't get to snip snip. I get to shoot shoot. Glad you only bet 1.5k. Yeah, that is. I am wishing I had been a more frugal man, but here I am. I say this as if they couldn't turn it around, but I do legitimately think that they get a few items under their belts, and there is the ability to, you know, actually have that engage go off and this Cassiopeia get popped when they just don't have the damage. I mean, the people who are dealing damage in that engage are the Jinx and the Nox. The Nox just on Stridebreaker, and the Jinx didn't have, I think, Eye Edge at that point, so you're not really getting that much damage to follow up on the engage, so, like, time will tell if they can hold on. Committing for this top tower, but I don't know if Gwen wins this. Her shield's down, but you know what? Committed for the tower. It's like, you know what? I want this objective bounty. We want this turret down. Give us a little bit more pressure on the map. And Steven commits for it. We're going to see third Drake spawning. How soon? 7 seconds. And GB, they're hanging out here on bottom side, but they don't have the vision or the pressure to really contest this. I wish they were, you know, pushing down mid lane, or the Nocturne was, you know, getting vision somewhere else, because this dragon's going to go down. They don't have vision of it, and meanwhile, Quinn is taking top inhibitor tower, so it's just one of those positions where you feel like you're pulled across the map, you feel like you have to contest it, but you end up squandering that time when you really have got no business being there. PJ's claiming that Nick Mead will get 3 kills, and then the game will be over. He is almost flame horizoning Angela. Arrow goes wide. Nick Mead casually sidesteps it. Good engage out of the Rakan onto 4 members. The Galio comes over the top. This is the fight we are looking for. The Jinx is getting to free hit. The Trundle, though, is just... Oh, my God. Adam, why you gotta do him like that? That's just rude. And pop goes to Gwen. And despite a very valiant fight out of GB... In fact, better than I think most people would have thought it went. They end up still getting 4-for-2'd. The Trundle just gets into the middle of that fight and is... I mean, that man is killing Galio in like 2 chomps. That is a fed Trundle. The Cassiopeia, 3 items. No tank will withstand that onslaught. And then you've got this annoying 3-1-6 Quinn. It's like, oh, cool. You killed Ash. We've got a Quinn. And we don't really care because we've got another AD carry. So, But, ladies and gentlemen, that did go better than the last time they engaged on the Cassiopeia. So you know what? We said 15 minutes last time. Now I'm saying 10 minutes from now, that engage will work, and they'll win the fight. 10 minutes from now. They're only 1 inhib down. They're not looking too stressed. But only time shall tell. Oh, Nick Mead, I know you need to get big, but that is a dangerous lane to farm. Luckily, nobody is bot side, but good lord, a Jinx that far out past her second tier tower at 26 minutes into the game is a bold place to be. Mr. Satan confirmed THD hater. You heard it here first. I don't like the way Adam treated me the last time we played. We've got an arrow going top. Gwen is not immune for that arrow. She is stunned for, in fact, a million years. Steven recognizes the punishment that's coming and turns onto the Quinn. But I think it is only a matter of time until Adam gives him a chomp. Gives him a bonk. Bonk. And Angela gets her first kill. Or second kill, excuse me. That is a lethality Ashe. Going full CDR, maximum arrows. Oh my god, this is Giga Brain. The Ashe is purely engage and poke, whereas the Quinn is like the actual carry. This is... I like this. This is intellect that I did not see. Nick Meat is big. Everybody, yes, I agree with all of y'all. That is a 200th the most farm in the game. Despite being on the team down almost 10k gold, is 1,000 up on his lane opponent. Let's see how big Nick Meat can get, and can he stop the second Baron out of THD? Will be interesting. What other gold leads are we looking at? We're looking at a 1,000 gold lead top, so not horrible. 5k plus gold lead in the jungle. That's a tough one. You've got 3k. Not 3k. Yeah, a little over 3 mid lane. 1,000 in Jinx's favor. And then support his support. So. A little bit of gold diff there, yeah. But again, we saw one fight where it went very poorly, even with the Wombo. We saw one fight where it went okay with the Wombo. I think the next fight is going to go just fine with the Wombo. Oh, the Gwen is walking into people. We're diving onto the Lethality Ashe. This zones everybody off the fight and creates a lot of like opportunity for GB to fight. The ultimates come down, but it just looks like, oop, I am a liar. Doesn't look like there's too much damage. Can they kill this Trundle? This is the question. Can he get kited out? I don't think he will. Oh, he walks into the Jinx traps. Okay, okay. Nick Mead? Nick Mead, now is your time? Is this the play? Oh, never mind. The game's over. The fight went well. I said it was going to go well. They just get backdoored. The Quinn. How could we forget about the Quinn? He did. He did. You said Nick Mead would get some kills, and he did. Too bad Quinn's like, you know what? Your Nexus looks a lot nicer than any kills I could get. And that is a game one victory to THD. Harder to execute comp, and you know what? They executed it. They built themselves a nice big wallet diff and just gave them a nice smack with it. But we'll see how GB can respond in game two if they go back to a similar full dive strategy. To be determined. Post game one, though, I think the dive comp wasn't actually too problematic. I think a problem was that they don't have enough of a front line with, can I get, what the hell is it called? Draft link, please. I think they just didn't have enough beef. I think the Nocturne and Gwen and Rakan are all like, they're bruisery, they get kind of strong, but they're not like, Galio's going in, he's your real only front line in those fights, and like, yeah, so Trundle can just ult him, and then they shred him with all of the damage they had on the THD side. I think I don't think Nishant Sejuani was banned. I think Sejuani there, while can't not able to get as deep as the Nocturne can, accomplishes somewhat of a similar goal of being able to just kind of like dive in, give the Galio somebody to jump on top of. You still have the Rakan as an engage option for the Galio to leap on. So I think that would have given him a bit more beef. And, you know, maybe help that initial engage go a little smoother when you've got these two big meatballs. But we will see what adaptations GB make in game two, because that looked like a THD from that first invade topside, killing Steven and then shortly thereafter killing Nishant. Looked like a pretty convincing THD win. Oh, I gotta do Gamba, don't I? I gotta do Gamba. I gotta forfeit my points to all of you people. Who will win? THD won, right? Yeah, those people won. Complete prediction. Are you sure THD is the correct outcome? Yes, Twitch, I'm sure. Complete. Okay, everybody, enjoy your points. Plus 85k. Damn, man, swimming in it. Even Twitch believes Nick's team is just better. True. I mean, 10 people did vote for GB that game and only 3 for THD. So you know what? I think chat believed in the goodness of the boys, but THD didn't really care. Working on draft, not working for me. Getting Glenn descendant. Yeah, no, it was doing that for me earlier when I was testing it. It was like you hit the like start button on draft lol and it just doesn't give you the page with all of the links and then you're stuck and it sucks. I'm wondering if GB pivots any of their bans this game, because we saw them throw what, 2 bans at Adam. They hit the Xinzhao. And they hit something second rotation. I can't roll. I have draft lull up. I'm a dumbass. I can just pivot over to that, can't I? What did we see last time? We saw... Okay. What do you pivot here if you're GB? What was the problem? The cast was a problem, but you've already hit Xerath, Vel'Koz, and Syndra, so it's like, oh god, can you really spare a 4th ban? Maybe get rid of that Singed? I mean, I don't know if the Singed is, like, ultimately that big of a threat. The Quinn ended up getting big. And Glenn's got all of this eclectic shit that he'll pick top lane. Like, sort of like when you've got somebody who, like, last season would run Janna top and unironically carry on it. It's like, you're sort of stuck in the rock in a hard place of, do you really want to have to ban some of the more eclectic weird matchups? I feel like Steven's seen everything top lane, so, like, he should be able to prepare accordingly, but... it's tough. You hit some of the main threats and they still pulled out stuff and said, hey, we're going to beat you on some of our secondary threats. Not working for me either. Can also use Pro Draft. Up to y'all. I hope that works with stream. Oh, baby, we're going to see a new draft coming up. Oh my goodness, we got quite the number of people here. I'm just your up-and-coming Twitch streamer. Remember to like, comment, and subscribe. Okay, we're swapping over to Pro Draft. So hopefully we should have that up. Begging me, Tio Glenn. Okay, cool. We should have that hopefully up in half a second. I need to remember how the hell to change the link in the pick ban. Spectra for game 2. Okay. Let's see if this works. doesn't know, don't go to that. Actually, yes, go to this. Properties. Okay, let's see if this works. If it doesn't, you can blame. Who do we blame if this doesn't work? I blame Angela if this doesn't work. Okay, let's see if this goes through. Okay. That looks just fine. Angela, you're off the hook. It looks fine on my screen, chat, but tell me if it looks like poopy and I'll try and do something. Oh, if you want to do the gamba, I've got gamba up right here. It'll be fine. It'll be fine. Who will win game two? You got to let me flex my up-and-coming Twitch streamer skills, Worm. You can't steal it all from me. We're going to do GB is blue, THD is pink, because that are their colors. Gamba period, let's just set it to 15, and let's start this. Don't show this again. Got it. Cool. New gamba is up. We'll type R again, because draft has not started. Okay, we're kicking it off. Bans starting. Okay, Zaya coming out. Nick Me bans, and Zhao. Not seeing a lot of changes from last time. We're going to see coming out here. A lot of these are pretty standard. I like the Zaya. I like the Nautilus. Forces Schluckbeer and Nick Mead onto some more immobile and less safe options in things like the Zyra and things like the Jhin that are relatively immobile. So it's interesting to see. Okay, did GB miss a ban? I bet on the wrong team. Trundle. Okay, so they do pivot. They take the Trundle off the table. And Yone from THD, Steven, get him off his comfort. So we're looking at two jungle bans from the side of GB, hitting Adams, classic Xin Zhao, the Trundle that he just bonked him over the head with. Don't leave the Zyra up. I think you can leave the Zyra up. Just draft the Nocturne and the Zyra can't play the game. And Kindred, they say, hey, you know what, Adam? You were a big problem, and we don't want you to be a problem anymore. So let's take some of your favorite toys off the table and see what you're going to play with now. We'll see how he responds, because he has a lot of picks. Return of the Sejuani. Nope, they take the Zyra. Worm called it. First pick, Zyra out of THD. Does Blazone play it, or is this an Angela pick? Or a Nathan pick, for that matter. I don't even know. Flex pick, baby. Flex picks are monumental in this league. Nathan Zyra? Yeah, you're saying Mazed Mecha. This seems like a Blazon. Like, he could pilot this, and it would be terrifying. Yep, the Jhin for Nick Mead. This is the GB draft I know and love. Take Zaya off the table, and Jhin is the secondary fallback 98% of the time. I'm predicting a jungle pick here. Might I see a Sejuani? You've banned the Trundle. Take the Sejuani. Nocturne again. They go back to it. Interesting. I thought that the Nocturne was last game. I think, you know, especially after getting set behind early with the invade, it was hard to kind of claw back, and the Nocturne was struggling to get the kills he needed to really start threatening backline. But GB says, you know what? We're going to pivot right back to it. I actually love Nocturne Jhin as a combo because Jhin can follow up on Nocturne ults with his, and it, you know, allows all the slows and things to come in. Then if anybody flashes away from the knock, the Jhin can follow up with, you know, additional shots to slow them and hopefully eventually take them down. So I actually kind of like that combo. On THD's side, we see a Twitch bot lane. The rat, everybody's favorite. And in a Mumu, almost instant locked for THD. I, once again, have no idea where, aside from the Twitch, that a Mumu, that Zyra, those are flexible picks. And who the hell knows where THD plans on throwing those. And the Rakan for GB. So they're looking at, you know what? The Jinx wasn't the right choice. Jhin can follow up.
better on some of the dive we drafted. We're going to go for the same thing. Hitting the Cassiopeia. So GB, even if they read the Zyra is mid, they are not. They don't want to see the Cassiopeia. They don't want to see it again. Is this the same exact bans out of good old THD? Nope. They banned Zyra last time and left it up this time. What did they swap? They swapped Nautilus. Oh, they took the Nautilus off the table. I see. Sylas ban. Okay. Syndra ban. So hitting 3 picks of Atoms, first rotation. 2 picks of Maze Mecha, second rotation. Makes sense. Now THD is going, what can Steven play topside that we don't want to deal with? Things he can turn against us. And I like the Sylas and the Aurelia. I don't think I've actually seen his Aurelia. No, I've seen his Aurelia in a BTL game. I don't remember it going well. Oop. GB, lock in the Akali. That I assume is... Somebody in chat can probably better educate me. I don't think Nikolai plays Akali. So is this an early... I can't imagine they're early showing Steven's pick if they're on red side. But... it is a takeaway from Mazed Mecha, though. So... yeah, with the Sylas ban, there could be a Malphite angle. Orianna. So that pretty much confirms... oh, no. Oh, my God. Is THD going to do the thing where they swap... where they're going to swap Mazed Mecha bottom lane support on Zyra. Angela's going to go mid on the Orianna. I'm calling it now. Screw the Gamba as it is. The Gamba is this Orianna going mid, and is it Angela or is it Mazed Mecha? I'm calling it Angela. A Scion pick for Glenn. That is a composition that I very much like out of THD. It's kind of boring, kind of basic, but damn, do they do some damage. They've got some front line. The Orianna is just such a good utility mid laner. Like, God, I like that composition. Like, all of those meat walls, the Orianna shields. Okay, and there's the Malphite pick out of GB. This could be a Steven mid swap on the Akali. And don't tell the boys is going top on the Malphite. Only time will tell. THDR. Okay, cool. I'll hit him with a spec R. Let's swap over to the client, ladies and gentlemen. And we will get ready for this game too. Huh? Where's my OBS? I've lost everything. Client, there we go. Okay. You hate the Rakan pick. Let's go back to pick ban until the draft, until we see more... in client. You hate the Rakan pick. Oh. Well, they canceled the draft anyway, so you know what? We're A-okay. Yeah, I mean, I agree with the Rakan pick being somewhat suboptimal. I think it's probably, I don't know, and I hate saying it like this because it sounds like, I don't know, Schluckbeer's champ pool? And so it might be a champ pool issue of with the Nautilus off the table. What is the next, you know, most comfortable engage support for him? And Rakan might be that option. But I do agree that perhaps a Leona, if they wanted to commit harder for fights, that might have been a better option. But it might just be a comfort where do or die, backs against the wall. Gotta take what you can get. He does prefer Rakan over Leo. Yeah, I assume it's comfort. If there's anything in my prep for GB that I did for our playoff series a few weeks back, is this team defaults back to comfort bottom lane in almost every single game they play. And it makes them somewhat predictable, but you could argue that in a league like BTL, comfort is paramount to almost anything else. So, and I agree with Alki. He had some real good engages last game. Hitting 3-4 members with his ulti, with the quickness, setting up some of the wombo combos that ended up, you know, not quite panning out, but we'll see. Yeah. And I like the fact that here, GB has an idea and they're sticking with it. Where the Zyra went unbanned. Oh, no, the Zyra one was first picked. Never mind. I'm a dumbass. Ignore me. Ignore my commentary. Back against the wall, though. Steven's pulling out the Akali. Oh, I haven't even looked at the Gamba. What is our Gamba looking like that I can't predict on? Because then it won't let me complete the thing. Oh my god. 88,000 THD. Okay, so we've got five people voting for GB. Free, or six. Okay, okay. We're getting some value bettors in there, but, you know, who dropped the big bucks? Who was that? Who dropped the big ones? Let's find out. Predictions, not end submissions. I want to see the summary. Summary, there it is. Who dropped the big bucks? Okay, Nick Mead dropping 2K on his own team. I like to see it. Caribou dropping 336 onto GB. Okay. Worm is just flexing his points after he just got his 85,000. He's like, why don't I drop all of it on THD this game? All in every match. You know what? That was a lifestyle I used to live by. Not much anymore. Okay, now that we're finally, they've just gotten through first ban phase. Now we will swap over to client just so everybody can see what's going on there. Let's swap over to client real quick. Boop. So Psy on top lane. We expected that. That is not anything new to any of us. Malphite. Oh god, I wasn't paying attention when we were in pregame lobby. Did it say don't tell the boys or Kairosaki Ace is picking when they locked in the Malphite? Who the hell knows? Caribou on the Amumu. Damn, I hope my bet's not wrong. But I can't Gamba, Dans. If I Gamba, I can't close the Gamba at the end. You complete it. Oh, ho ho. Dan is helping me out here. How much time do we got left? Let me drop. Okay, see, the problem is that what's the point of betting when I want to bet on THD and I'm going to get no return? Value bet. No, I just value betted and lost 15,000 points. That's not value. That is the opposite of value. I you know I want to bet. Okay. Okay, you know what? I have doubted Steven before. I will give him the respect he is due and stake my points on his Akali this game. You know what? You know what? Fine. Where the hell is the bet? Custom amount. This is just people who have bet on THD wanting to get better value for their points, but there you go. Yes, I still want to participate. Okay, cool. There it is. I slightly evened things out. You bet, Crank. I want some return. If I'm going to invest Worm, I want some semblance of return. Because if I'm not getting any return, what's the point of investing? Okay. I told y'all that is a Zyra-mazed mecha bottom lane. Angela's going mid on the Orianna. I called this shit. They can't trick me. I know the pick bans better in this league better than the people on their own teams do. No surprises for Mr. Satan. And Steven takes the Akali. Yeah. We get it. This all makes sense. The sad thing is unlike game one, where I thought GB had an unga bunga press R key win game comp, easier to execute, I think they have drafted a much harder to execute composition when their backs are against the wall. They've really got to get lanes rolling. Like, if I think what will be hugely important is if they can get bot lane even slightly ahead, right? Like, if this can get marginally ahead and this Jhin can start two-tapping Twitch and Zyra, that's a lane that Jhin will just walk all over. And we all have seen Nick Mead on the Jhin walk all over people. But it's just a matter of they need probably that assistance, because Twitch Zyra is likely going to have them shoved and likely going to have pressure on them, that they're going to need some support out of Nishant on this Nocturne to hopefully unlock them bot side. But yeah, we shall see. I think it's going to be hard to execute. Whereas on THD side, Sion, Orianna, Twitch, like, you got, if they, I hope that they Twitch Submarine an Orianna ulti in at some point this game. Not the best person to be submarining Orianna ult on, but it is still hilarious. And then Twitch just opens up and kills everybody. But it would also be quite funny, because I think that would be the best synergy that Nathan and Angela show when they aren't even in lane together. But, you know, to be determined on if they go for the combo once they get to the mid game. I think THD ran this style of composition, though, in one of their prior playoff rounds. I think it was in their SB set, and I think they ended up losing the game where they swapped Blazon bot and Angela mid. I could be wrong on whether they won or lost that match, but they've pulled this strategy out before, and I am very preferential to teams that pull out eclectic lane swaps and will, you know, prioritize people getting comfort and in lanes they know how to play and champions they know how to play, and being willing to say Zyra is an important pick. Blazon can pilot this bot and support, and Angela can easily roll swap mid, and being willing to make these, you know, decisions in the draft phase that will catch the enemy off guard. Here we are, getting into games. Let's swap over to the client. Dan is saying, if Malphite and Nott get on the Rat and Ori, I do think that is true and obviously a threat, but it's also tough if this Nocturne doesn't get off the ground, kind of like last game. I'm not sure the Ori is really going to be threatened, and with the shields that might be coming in from the Orianna onto the Twitch, I don't know, and Twitch has got exhaust, so who knows how much the Twitch will feel threatened, but...
The Summoner's Rift.
Damn. Evidently, 30 seconds until minions spawn. No friendship ended TBH. You know what? Adam's playing a Moomoo. I understand ending friendship with him. That is a completely respectable decision. Swap our lanes around, and we're good. Awesome. God, where was my friend who told me how to live my life? It's Control Shift X to zoom out. Please don't blow anything up. Control Shift Z. There we go. Okay. Getting real far out there. Oh, hello. Sion. Hello, Malphite. Look at these two big boys. They're just going to beat the hell out of each other, and it's going to be great. So Adam got an early ward on the top river, goes back for his sweeper, the high-tier jungle strat that I don't follow because I stick with yellow ward all game like a pleb. Lots of Zyra plants. Nice leash for the Amumu, who doesn't take much damage anyway. Oh my goodness, I would love that sort of leash. Damn. Elise and Ben don't give me leashes like that. Okay. Oh shit, I didn't swap the Akali and the Malphite. Bam. There we go. Now we're good to go. So, inverse jungle start. Amumu starting his bot side, looking like he's full clearing. Nocturne doing around the same thing. Amumu with a much better leash, though, is already probably 56% of the way done with these raptors. And Nocturne is just now starting his Raptors. Mumu already making his way onto his fourth camp, and Nocturne just exiting this topside jungle. I'm sorry if I showed preferential treatment towards jungle pathing. I like it. Makes me feel comfortable. Okay, we've got these two big meatballs just beating the hell out of each other. Oh boy! Get your grass procs, boys. Get nice and big. So when you show up at 20 minutes, you just never die. So GB's bottom lane with early pressure. Once Zyra starts... She's got her W now and her Q, so she can really start laying out some plants. So hopefully we'll get her lave shoved back out a little bit more. Steven dives in onto the Orianna, but he doesn't seem to remember that Angela is the best mid in BTL. And you can't just dive on to Angela's Orianna. Some trades going down bot lane. Huge root out of Maze Mecha. That's a lot of damage onto Nick Mead. He's going to go down to the Ignite and Twitch Poison. And Nocturne is here just a tad too late to get that pressure we were looking for in the bottom side. Angela flexing her best mid and BTL skills. That's a Twitch kill onto the Twitch. Trade of sums out of Twitch and Jhin, so that is now a flashless, exhaustless Twitch. Zyra's got flash. Rakan's got flash ignite. Goodness. Zyra, stop it. That is rude. Huge knock up onto the Malphite and a grass proc. Just for good measure. There's a ward, but Nishant might be looking for this play anyway. He needs to just run in here. He needs to just path straight in. Look at the Twitch. Not at the Zyra. Twitch has no flash. Good flash. He knows the Twitch is sumless. So they make the play onto it, but the Amumu is here off the reset, but it does not matter. He's got another Q. There's a lot of damage coming down. A lot has been committed by the GB jungler, and he goes down as well. So ultimately, trade jungle for AD carry. Some flashes out of both jungles. Active bottom lane. Nick Mead is luckily the recipient of a kill and is building up a little bit of a CS lead. I assume Tactical Gazelle will be able to collect most of this wave when he gets back and neutralize some of that lead, but... All I know is I've seen Maze Mecha hit some real nice roots and like double and triple plants that have really turned some of these trades. Early gold on the Nick Feet. The Nick Feet is in fact behind 40 gold currently. Oop, Nikolai goes in and takes down two hands, but I don't think this tower and the Scion clone are gonna let him live. Nope, but you know what? Just flex on him a little bit, Nikolai. You play mid and you're like, you know what? I actually can play top lane and kill you. Respect. Flash on that Scion. Make him blow passive. Oh, Schluck, that was a bit short. Almost dies to the tower damage and Twitch poison. Oop. Oh, Steven goes in, flashes over the tower, over the raptor wall, and he is out of there. Unless Maze Mecha starts making a move up. They're sniffing him out. They're like, you know what? You just killed the best mid in BTL. You don't get to get away with that. And this Amumu is on the hunt. No! Adam! You walked right by him! And that Akali is gone! She's out of there. Well, and you know what? He regained enough health and all of that that he's like, you know what? I might just stick mid. I might just chill and grab some minions on my way out. Oh, two hands. The real final boss is here. Oh, no. The greedy recall finally bites him in the end after the great escape. The Scion rotating down through the topside. They'll never expect the Scion in the Raptor camp. Oh, goodness, Steven. You win some, you lose some. Oh, yeah, no, that Q was just, like, literally, like, on the edge of the hitbox. That's one of those ones that I bet you on certain Scion skins, the, like, hit indicator, that definitely wasn't in the hitbox with how wonky that hit indicator is. You know what? That's, funnily enough, even though Nikolai got that, you know, 1v1 kill and he traded himself over and with two hands getting that kill on the Akali, he's got a bounty for himself top lane. And a Sion with a bounty is a scary thing. Can I check their grasp procs? Let me do that real quick. What are you looking at, Nikolai? You're looking at... Oop. Two hands is ulti here, and he's got ghost. This Malphite is, he's gonna have to press R, and I'm sure, yep, there it comes. Almost instantaneously, two hands, follows up with an ulti of his own. And that's a rock that, got turned into some rubble. The choo-choo train ran right on over that mountain. Okay, Steven seeing blood. He's trading aggressively. Sneaky, sneaky. And he comes immediately out of sneaky, sneaky. Damn. So Nick Mead's going to catch this pretty big wave and have a nice CS lead for himself. Safely farming it up, but I think the problem we're running into is that there needs to be some lane with an advantage for GB side, and I don't know if the Akali is enough to really get them the map pressure they need. Do I have enough to have the other overlay active to swap? No. Elena told me that there was a different overlay that you run, but she told me I was getting the junior varsity, you know, new hire overlay. I wasn't good enough to have the fancy overlay or whatever you had, so we are stuck with what you see right now. It's my first day on the job. They weren't trusting with that level of power. I'm lucky I even got to do the gambas. Oh God, you know what? Oh gosh, this is a tragedy, because I'm sitting here at 10 minutes going, how is Good Boys going to deal with this 3-1-0 Sion? Look at their composition. Akali, horrible at killing Sion. Jin, somewhat laughable at killing Sion. And then you've got a Nocturne. That's a resident Nocturne player here. No, not a fun Nocturne kill. And Malphite sure as hell isn't going to kill him. So this Sion getting big? Rather problematic in the grand scheme of things. Oop, we're seeing a gank bot side. Caribou just misses the bandage toss, but he ends up just ulting the Rakan, and he says, oh, thank you. I missed you, and I'm just going to ulti you. Oh, my God. Two hands, not the rock. And the rock says, you know what? I'm out, if I foul. You can't touch me. Dashes right out of there. With that gank bottom lane, yeah, despite Caribou missing the initial bandage toss, he just presses R when the Rakan gets within 5 feet of him and says, you know what, we'll kill you instead. But Nick Mead opens up, ends up killing Mazed Mecha, and Caribou, in defending his bottom lane, might just trade his life. Oop. Best mid in BTL, baby. And then Nishant comes in to defend his bottom lane, turn a kill back onto the Amumu. And Nick Mead, ladies and gentlemen, that's a 3-1-0 Nick Mead at 11 minutes. I'm seeing inklings of something that can kill this Sion. Inklings. Please keep two hands on the rock at all times. I agree. Schluck, are you caught out? Nope, you're Rakan. You just dash over the wall. I love Rakan. Goddamn, that champ is so good. Holy moly. I think Melio is the only support I like better than Rakan. He just walks up, pops his shield, and is like, hey, give me a grasp stack, kid. And then walks away. He's a bully. Sion's a bully. Don't hurt the rock. Oof, gank mid. No ult out of the Akali, though, so we're not going to see a kill here, but definitely chunks out the Orianna. I think with the Crown of the Shattered Queen, that's a tough kill to take. But you know what? I think Angela's tracked back in, what season are we in? Season 13? In season 12, when she played mid and Crown was like the go-to item for all mid laners. I don't think she realizes Crown is not the pick anymore. But you know what? Against Nocturne Akali, who am I to judge the best mid in BTL? And you know what? It probably kept her alive there. So maybe I'm just talking out my ass, but we'll see. There'll be a kill where she would have gotten a kill with Ludens, and I'll call attention to it. Huge flank out of the Akali, but they know she's there because she's on a ward, but immediate flashes out of the THD bottom lane. Goodness, Steven, you didn't even give him a chance. Gets out, but Tactical Gazelle flashes over the wall. He's committing for this fight. And with the Rakan shields and heals, the Twitch poison is not going to be enough to burn him down. Oh dear, we hear the choo-choo train. The Nocturne ult is coming in. All of the follow-up. But then the huge Amumu ult into a huge Orianna ult. Wombo combo, ladies and gentlemen. The Scion, the choo-choo train has arrived. He decided, the rock's not enough. Give me the spooky ghost too. And you know what? Why don't you give me this actor for, good measure. Jid's an actor, right? The mask? No, he's a painter. He paints shit with blood. No, I'm messing up my artistic endeavors. I'm an engineer. I don't know what the artsy people do. But big wins for THD. Off of a play that GB started with the Akali roam bot. I think it was a good idea out of the Akali after getting the Orianna sent back to base. He's got wave shoved in. Wants to apply that pressure elsewhere. Ulti's back up. Let's go bot lane for this squishy Twitch and Zyra. And it looks great to start, but they just were able to peel and kite for so long. The Orianna comes back from base. The Amumu's there. The Scion is able to ult to bot lane and get into the jungle. I'm rambling about that fight at this point, but ultimately it was a great turn by THD. Oh, now we're getting Grasp and Heartsteel stacks. Two hands is double bullying now. And I'm not sure, but Sheen and Kindle Gen, that looks like a frozen fist out of the Malphite, so the Malphite's not going to be getting those sick, nasty Heartsteel stacks onto the Scion. Oop. Engage onto the Akali, who just goes over the wall. Dragon assist. Gotta love when Dragon helps you out. Gotta love when Dragon's on your side. Oh. And the smite out of the Amumu. He says, you know what? You're not getting away this time. I am smiting this Akali. No more dashes for you. Oop. Ultimately onto the Amumu, but the Amumu doesn't have much gas left in the tank. That's going to be a dead Twitch. Schluck a beer with an excellent Zhonya's to survive Twitch Expunge. He might still die to poison. Nope, ends up living, and that is a one fight for the good boys. Nick Mead is opening up the ultimate, giving vision. Ooh, Nocturne goes in a little too deep and too low, but you know what? Ends up giving the Rock a kill. Just what the Rock ordered. I am seeing a 3-2-0 Rock now. So ultimately, GB able to win that one. Get some map pressure. No Dragon off of it, though, with junglers down. However, I'm seeing, a split push Scion that... Yeah, Steven, I think you could dump your energy bar two or three times over into this guy, and you're not killing him with, three of your energy bars. Yeah, meanwhile, Scion's just like, thank you for the tower. And we're back on Dragon. Amumu ult is back up. Nocturne and Akali ults are down. Jhin ult still down. Rakan ult still down. So Caribou's looking for something here. He's sniffing it. He knows I've got Amumu ulti. You guys don't. Look at this Rock. Ooh, and he gets onto the Jhin in the brush. Doesn't even know the Jhin is there. The Jhin has to kite back out. Tactical Gazelle's in the middle of a Nocturne fight, though. End up going 1-for-2 in favor of THD. They end up getting the Dragon. The flash out of Caribou misses Nick Mead. Schluckbeer is going to once again save his carry, and they are going to run on out of there. Oh, but Scion says, I see a dead... Oh my god, that chunk onto the Rakan. And Steven's here. What's he going to do? That's a dead Zyra. Understandable. Have a nice day. I don't think you guys killed that. The overdiving. Oh! Angela, you stepped up a little too far, and Steven takes that one. Oh my god, see, this is what I look like. No, you guys aren't gonna kill this guy. You're not gonna kill either of these guys. This is the tragedy. Nick Mead, shoot him! We killed one of those guys. Now, can we kill the bigger guy? The Rock is here, and the Rock is angry. The Rock wants retribution. but I don't think he's gonna get it. Nikolai, you're just giving him heart steal and grasp stacks. It's not worth it.
Here's something that won't wash off.
Ah, a lot of chaos. But ultimately, looking at the scoreboard, looking at both gold difference, looking at dragon difference, a far closer game than we saw last time. We saw the Nocturne on the Twitch there, and even with two other people around him, the Nocturne was a potent threat onto the back line there, so that's a good change. The fact that you give this Jhin some space, and outside of Sion, he will kind of get through people. Once again, a catch onto the Akali. Huge fight going on. The Zyra has blown everything, and so she is getting out of the fight. Despite being chased, the Jhin ult is not able to connect. Sion is in a 1v3. I do think he's going to be just fine. He's just going to get some Heart Seal stacks. Ultimately, a trade again, 1-for-2 in favor of THD. Health bars aren't looking great. The Amumu is down, but Harold ends up going in GB's favor. So you know what? One less kill, but you got Harold. You probably take that. That's a win. And Sion back to Sion things. Remember when I said this is a 2-1-0 Sion? I don't know how anybody kills him. It is now a 5-1-0 Sion. I don't know how anybody kills this. Okay, let's see. Let's see. You've got two goons versus a Sion with Heart Steal and Grasp. Two hands, you better take those stacks. You better just bonk them. Take your stacks. Don't let them kill you without taking the stacks, at least. Just... Ooh. Catch onto the Rakan. Two hands might look to turn this when he gets ulti in like half a second. However, for how much I toot this Sion's horn, ladies and gentlemen, that is a 5-1-6 Nick Mead Jhin. That is a Nick Mead Jhin with the most gold in the game by about 200. Most gold on his team by over 1,000. So Nick Mead is setting the stage for himself to perform. Bork Jhin. I don't know what I'll do if he builds Bork on Jhin. Oh, Nashawn, your Krugs are up. What are you backing for? Resetting for Dragon. You get your Hex Drinker. Longsword. Wear your Pink Wards, Nashawn. You've got a Dragon coming up. Sell that Longsword and buy Pink Wards. Do not exit base without a Pink Ward, ladies and gentlemen. Especially you got a Dragon coming up in, what, 37 seconds? Pink Wards are critical for objective setups. Oop. Engage onto the Orianna, who once again crowned the Shattered Queen, so she ends up being relatively okay. Huge trade back from her own ultimate onto the two that engaged onto her, and that is a huge fight win for THD. Big overstep onto an Orianna that has crown. She has her own shield, she's got crown, and THD says, you know what? Dragon, that's weak sauce. We're going straight to Baron. And with that, that 1k, 1.5k gold lead we saw in the favor of THD is blown to 5.5. This Baron's going to extend it to what? 6, 7.5? And now with Baron buff to play with, Nocturne's got to drop this Herald, and I don't know where it's going to go. It's going to go mid. I don't think we've got much damage on any of the towers. Directed Cam, let me take over real quick. No, Director Cam's not letting me take over. That's okay too, Director Cam. I didn't want to take over. Is Shelly even going to get her charge off here? GB wants this dragon, and it looks like THD says, you know what, y'all can have it. We're going to just force you guys to get here as 5 while we take top tower with Sion, while we kill your Shelly mid. We'll give you that objective bounty, and Orianna ult is used to chunk the Malphite. Keep them pinned while Sion is just split pushing topside. GB says now is our time to shine. They dive in, but that is a Sion TP into the fight. He was ready for this. They knew he needed to come in. Gets a tower topside and is like, you know what? Give me a few kills for good measure. Oh my god. Nick, run. Run, Jin. Oh god. No. Please have mercy. Ah, that's Sion. Holy shit. Sion, 6-1-2, ladies and gentlemen. Interactive gameplay when he just CCs you from 100 to 0. No big deal. They're going to take this tower through back door. No, they're going to collect their minion wave. They're smart. They know. Hey, our minions are right here. Caribou, stand there so you keep keeping the there it goes. Good. Keep the cannon minion pumped up. Sion health check. I would honestly check Sion health, but when I said that it wouldn't, like, I tried clicking back into the client and it gave me my default Windows mouse, and I don't want it to, like, screw over the stream, so I don't want to click the client again and screw everything up. Can't we count by his health bars? Where is the man? Show me Sion. Okay, so I can interact with the client. Oh, no, but I just have the Windows mouse. Okay, no, we're good. We're fine. 5.2k health. With 930 off Soul Furnace. He's got, what, 343 off Heartsteel. And, oh, we got a fight. No time for checking Sion health. Root onto the Zyra, and they just back off. They realize, nope, we cannot win this. Here comes the choo-choo train. Who is he going to hit? Huge collision onto the Nocturne and the Akali. Lots of damage coming out. And despite a good dive by the good boys onto the likes of THD, the Amumu just says, look at my health bar, look at Sion's health bar, and walk away. Nick Mead, he knows he's got to do something. Then he sees that low health Orianna, and he's like, maybe if I get this one kill, we can turn the tide here. They're just going to take their recalls. I think they're smart in knowing we've got to just defend under Nexus Towers. We've got our team up in 10. We can't defend these inhibitors. Can you check runes? Can I check this man's grasp to see how much he's gotten? Is that not a thing in this client? Oh, can I check? If I click Sion and I click this. Here we go. 1,500 health off of grasp. What a champion. And Overgrowth, 270 health. What a goofy champion. Holy shit. Like, almost 3,000 in, like, bonus HP from runes and items and stuff. What a goofball. The nicest thing I could say about Sion. Oop. The sad thing is I think this combination of champions would take about 25 seconds to kill the Samumu. Oop. Blowing teleports and ulties just to escape the wrath of Caribou's Amumu. Oh my god! We see an engage going down mid. Nocturne ulti comes down to blind the likes of THD. And that is a dead Twitch and a dead Zyra, so good picks coming out of GB. They got some fight left in them. Orya ends up cleaning up a kill on the backside. Sion says, you know what? This is for my bottom lane. I'm going to yell aggressively at you. And I think that's all he's got. Doesn't even get a Heartsteel sack. Sad Sion. Commits Ghost and Ulti for not even a Heartsteel. All I know is Adam built Chemtank on Amumu. And I'm pretty sure Chemtank has like less than half a percent pick rate across like all games in terms of pick rate, and the man built Chemtank. So respect to building the underappreciated item. I'm glad that item's not in the game anymore, because when it was good, so were Udyr and Hecarim. And both of those champions are annoying. All I know is if we look at the burn our two tanks are getting out of their Sunfires, you'll notice the Scions is a larger number. Almost doubly so. In fact, over doubly so. Nikolai walking up a little far, but ends up, you know, just walking it out. He's Malphite.
I'll be right under their noses.
THD, with the map pressure they have super minions on Nexus Towers. They are able to rotate straight to Baron. In fact, they get a Nexus Tower. All of GB's having to go back to defend their base. They're losing a base tower up top. And this is a free Baron for THD. Got to do a little base defense, a little tower defense, if you will. No minions getting to your Nexus. And I think GB is showing some good inklings of coming back into this game. They found some good picks onto this immobile and squishy bottom lane when they've been out of position. The problem is this Scion is just all over the place. If they can finally take a fight where this Scion doesn't get to show up, doesn't get to TP in, doesn't get to ult, doesn't get to just run at them and scare them all away, there's a chance that GB can turn one of these fights. They're not under threat of soul quite yet. If they can live through this Baron and find an angle where Scion is not immediately involved, they have a shot at this fight. But 11k gold down, you're looking at gold leads in every role. Even Nick Mead is just 100 gold ahead of Tactical Gazelle. Steven's going for the last-ditch play. He connects onto the backline, and he blows up the Twitch. But Adam responds with a huge Amumu ult that just completely stops the dive onto the THD backline. They might be dead. But so is Malphite. So is Nocturne. So is the Akali. So are the divers. And Scion is like, hey, stand under your tower while we end this game. Oh, my God. The Chemtank Amumu is so fast. Just sprints Adam. Nick Mead is valiantly fighting for the last of his base, trades a kill onto Angela for good measure, but with these two tanks alive and this Scion being as big of a brute as he is, I don't see this game going anywhere but over. Valiant plays out of good boys. They have had a good run in the lower bracket, having a lot of 2-1 series, back and forth games, pop-off games with exciting carries and plays out of, you know, the entire team, but sadly, GB's run ends here, ends tonight. Good game to the good boys. And THD continues on to face the likes of Deep Dive next week. So, chat, who are we feeling? Because I'm the only person here, so it is my unilateral decision. But I'm feeling two hands for an interview here. His Quinn was pretty instrumental in the win in the first game, and then that Scion performance was quite nasty. So I'm thinking getting two hands in here, unless chat has anything demonstrably different to say. I'll give y'all like the next 20 seconds. Honor Nick Mead, the Jhin, went down valiantly, taking down the best mid in BTL with him. Okay, I am seeing nothing out of chat, so I will hop over to grab two hands. Give me a second. I just remembered I have to turn my Discord back up because I can't hear him.
Hello.
Hello, hello, Glenn. How are you? How are you feeling?
I'm feeling all right. I was nervous coming in because Steven is a better player than me, but, you know, everybody gets one.
Yeah, you know what? Also, Twitch chat, let me know if you can hear him because I know in the past there's been problems with Discord, but honestly, you say Steven was the better player, but after that Quinn game, he ran mid lane. So I'm not sure you should be doubting yourself so much after you trounced him on the Quinn. And I kind of wanted to start there because...
I said, okay.
Yeah, because I thought the draft you guys had was a lot harder to execute than GB's in game one. They had a lot of dive, a lot of just press R, win the game. Yeah. And you guys end up taking this Quinn top into the Gwen, which I thought was, you know, obviously an interesting matchup. But the fact that you sort of built more conventional AD carry, kind of like Quinn does, but Angela then pivots on the Ashe to building Duskblade and building Muramana and building, you know, all that CDR. So was that kind of a composition and a strategy you guys had going into this, or kind of what was the thought process around maybe the Quinn is our late game threat and the Ashe is
the
just...
The team comp was discussed beforehand. The 80 or the CDR Ashe was actually Big Brain, but it was, we didn't know that was going to happen until it happened. So, you know, and it worked out perfectly. You know, it was, she was slinging arrows and we were getting picks off of them. The Quinn pick was just comfort. I mean, she's one of my most played champs, but it's not always, it's good in the, it's decent into Steven. I don't want to say good into most of his picks. She's good into like bruiser types, bruiser hard carries, which is usually what he picks. So I was pretty comfortable there, and I figured they were going to camp for him. So, so I took Ghost, and, that kind of negated the top side, pressure.
Yeah, so, even after that first gank Nocturne, even after the first gank topside from the Nocturne, blowing both, I think, your Flash and your Ghost, you and Adam ended up invading the topside and killing Steven in Tribrush, and then following up with a kill shortly thereafter onto the Nocturne. Who was calling for that invade? Because as a jungler, I'm seeing, oh, Nocturne doesn't have blue. We can invade him on this topside with the pressure you had. So who's calling for that? Is that you or is that Adam saying, hey, we can go in on this guy?
That's actually our, like... I mean, this is even something that Steven pointed out to me in person one day. He was like, you guys create pressure through top and jungle a lot. Mm-hmm. And that's just something I think when we have that push or a counter pick top, then we know, like, we're messing with this jungle. We're going in there and, you know, we're either taking everything or someone's going to die. And they blew everything and we... just kind of naturally won the 2v2, which we planned in draft. So, yeah, that was a part of the plan. We just kind of instinctually both knew there was no call. We just stared at each other and was like, let's do it.
No, that was huge. And I think that ability to invade topside or invade together and have that, you know, camaraderie and knowing, hey, the two of us are going to force this and they can't stop us is immensely helpful. And knowing that, you know, you guys can make those plays and set yourselves up for success like that. And I think the Quinn pick, I thought it was a brilliant pivot given the Gwen had come in, and that sort of counters a lot of the tank matchups. And it's like asking you to, hey, pick a tank, pick something scaling, and Gwen will cut you down. So I think the Quinn pivot was huge in game one and ultimately, you know, ended up contributing a lot to that win you guys had. And then that brings us to game two, where you left Zyra, or you banned Zyra game one. And then it's left up game two. You guys have blue side. Once you knew you had blue, were you like, we're first picking Zyra away from Schluckbeer? We're just going to take this off the table to start because now we don't have to ban it because we can first pick it.
Yes, that was definitely a part of the plan. We wanted Jhin as well, but we figured that they would take that away if we took Zyra. We had switched Kyle to bot, and that was that's one of his strongest supports, so that's definitely a thing that we've wanted to try, but now is just like the perfect opportunity
I think that's huge. I think in BTL in general, the ability to take picks away from the opponent and pilot them effectively while also kind of reducing their effectiveness by taking away comfort is huge. And I think y'all's ability to swap Maze Mecha mid and Angela and Nathan bot and in support, and kind of those three just rotating around as needed, it allows you guys to have like a lot of fancier pick bans that it makes it very hard to predict. And like we saw here in the second rotation, they were still banning Cassiopeia and Syndra, and they were still banning Maze Mecha picks because they're like, we think this Zyra is going bot on support and we want to hit him, but that never seemed to be the plan.
Now, the Angela is a very, very good Orianna mid. Mm-hmm. And, we were a tad worried about Akali into that, because once we saw Akali, we knew Steven was going to mid.
Yeah.
But yeah, she played it perfect. So yeah, I can't say I'm surprised because she's really clean on Orianna. But yeah, we also had a lot of pressure bot through the Zyra pick and the Twitch for late game. I will say Kyle or Maze Mecha did a lot of draft planning for us, and I think he felt really good to have it like come to fruition. So.
No, and I think you guys drafted compositions that fit y'all well and what you wanted to do, and I think that like obviously that ended up panning out, and I think in the second game this is like an LCS style, like it's so much good mixed damage, a lot of like spam and burst, you know, with both Twitch and Ori doing good consistent damage, Zyra doing good consistent, lots of catch, it's a lot, two big meatballs, like you're lacking for nothing with this comp. This is like, I want to take a picture of this and put it on my wall. But at what point in this game, in this second game, 10-1-4 on Sion, I think you had like 3,000 HP almost from like items and runes and shit. At what point did you realize I'm facing a Jhin, an Akali, and a Nocturne? I'm unkillable.
Yeah, from the start, I said I'm not going to build any MR.
Good call.
I mean, right after I got 2 kills, I think, or like 3 kills, I was like, this is... I don't think I'm going to die for the rest of the game. There's just... It's too far gone. They didn't have really anything to stop me. The one time I thought they could have killed me was when... I think Akali and Malphite were top, and they were running me down. And I didn't have any CDs, but they still could manage it. And without MR, I knew for sure it was like, all right, well, I think I'm a little too far gone. And I had been practicing Sion because my blue side is really bad. I typically don't play tanks, so I had to practice someone specifically for this game when we knew they were going to be like, okay, well, we pick red side for Steven.
So. Yep. No, and you looked excellent on the Sion. You and I had the exact same thought process. You hit 2 kills, and I think it was you had gotten you got a bounty on your head then after you traded 1-for-1 in your first kill with Nikolai topside. And I looked at that point, I think in the VOD, I said, like, yeah, the Sion is now like who's gonna touch the Sion? And ultimately pilot it super well. Huge props to THD in clinching out this win. Clinching, that makes it sound like it was close. That was, you know, a very strong and convincing 2-0 for you guys. Looks like your next opponent is good old Deep Dive. Undefeated in the regular season, but currently in postseason is only 2-3. So how are you feeling going into that matchup?
Who's on Deep Dive? I remember
Avarion, QDAF.
Oh, Tathaniel, yeah, they Fire Knight. Smashed us last time. We obviously, you know, we have a master planner in our team, and, you know, we look to him a lot to, you know, tell us what he thinks would be nice and what would be nice into them. Mm-hmm. But I think we can beat anyone, even especially having them, like, beat us before. I think that only makes us like better against them, because we have only meshed better since the regular season. So yeah, I think Deep Dive will be I don't want to say 2-0, maybe 2-1.
I like it. Measured and very realistic confidence, and you know, actual logic and why you're confident going into that game. No, I'm glad to hear that. And then upper side of the bracket, you know, you don't have to play caster, you know, fan favorite over here, AR and SB. Who do you think's taking that one home? I have my inclination and my inkling, but who do you think, if you guys, you know, beat DD next week, who are you going to be facing in a losers finals, you think?
I actually have no idea. I have friends on both teams, so I don't know. It's hands to Jesus there. I want to play SB again personally for grudge reasons.
Okay.
But you know, but you guys are looking nice too, so it's hard to say.
Funnily enough, I think, you know what? If you guys keep winning, you'll get to face all of us again. So you know what?
Yeah,
that just might be the theory, is if you keep winning, you'll get, you know, revenge matches against DD, SB, and you guys absolutely smacked us around in the regular season. So if we meet y'all again, you know, that is a bit of a daunting matchup for us. But looking at chat, Adam wants me to read off a thing. And
okay.
2 hands, 3 legs, 4 playoff wins, 5 heads, 6 feet, 7 inches, 8 figures.
Oh, my God.
And now I need him to copy and paste his question, because he said he'd only give me his question if I... That's like the damn Captain America, like Winter Soldier,
like decoded that.
Yeah, the like sleeper code to wake you up.
He's still here. You didn't have a question.
Oh, God damn it, Adam. Okay, fine. Well, Glenn, thanks for joining us. Congrats on the win. I'm going to end stream here, but looking forward to see y'all play against DD next week. Any final shout-outs before I hit the finish button?
No, just like I said, big shout-outs to my team. Everyone played a huge part. I may have had a solid game, but it was highly through the effort of the rest of the team. I was just a bot delivering, what I was supposed to. They did all the heavy lifting, in my opinion. So
you hear it here first, ladies and gentlemen. League of Legends is a team game. There's no I in carry, and we all work together. So good games, THD. GB, sad to see you go, but we will see you back next season. And that is it for us on the cast.
All right. Thanks. Good luck in your game.
See y'all.
See ya.